No quickly growing to CD comparison between the dorsal spinocerebellar tract and the cunocerebellar tract because they begin as the same. So in order to do the integration, that is very, very useful to do it instead of just seeing the pathways apart. So let's begin. We begin with the neuromuscular and neurotendinous spindles. Neurotendinous spindles are Golgi tendon organs, neuromuscular spindles are annulospinal and flower free nerve endings. Here are the dendrites of pseudo-unipolar cells. The body lies on the dorsal root ganglia and they will enter to the posterior fascicle, posterior funiculus of the spinal cord. So this is the spinal cord, posterior horn, anterior horn, anterior horn, posterior horn. Next, we enter to gracilis or cuneatus. Let's begin from, we have like three levels. We have above T1, we have between T1 and L3, and below the lumbar level. So, if we are at the T1, L3 level, this neuron, the axon of this neuron, will end up here at the gracilis fascicle and will do synapse on the dorsal nucleus of Clark or thoracic nucleus. If this neuron is here at a level below the lumbar level, so the axons, these axons, let me put the spinal cord again. Here is the axon. This neuron will not synapse on gracilis because there is no dorsal nucleus of Clark, because the dorsal nucleus of Clark goes or appears only from T1 to L3. So these neurons will ascend through the fasciculus gracilis until arriving at this level when they now synapse on the dorsal nucleus of Clark. And now for this neuron that is above T1 will enter the spinal cord. Here will be the spinal cord. Here it is. At the cuneatus fascicle. And will synapse on the accessory nucleus of cuneatus. And will ascend. So we have now second order neurons. Now the second order neurons of the dorsal nucleus of Clark will cross posterior. And now lateral. So they ascend, they are ascending as the dorsal spinocerebellar tract, sorry, dorsal, dorsal spinocerebellar tract, because it's going from the spinal cord to the cerebellar cortex. Then the same for the second order neurons of the accessory nucleus of cuneatus. They will ascend as now as the cuneocerebellar tract. And they will end up also in the cerebellar cortex. Both axons of the dorsal nucleus of Clark end in the vermal cortex. And the ones of the accessory nucleus of cuneatus end up in the paravermal hemisphere cortex or the intermediate hemisphere cortex. So these are entering through the inferior cerebellar peduncle as Mossi fibers. And because they are Mossi fibers, they release glutamate to granular cells of the granular layer in the cortex of the cerebellum. And the granular cells release glutamate to Purkinje cells. Purkinje cells release GABA, an inhibitory neurotransmitter, to, if we are in the vermis, so in the through the spinocerebellar tract, these neurons, well, the neurons that synapse with granular cells, Purkinje cells, now these neurons will synapse on the fastigial nucleus. The ones that are coming, these Mossi fibers, that are coming from the accessory nucleus of cuneatus, granular cells, Purkinje cells, and now because they are in the intermediate hemisphere, the paravermal hemisphere, they synapse on the emboliform and globose nuclei, or interposed nuclei. And now these ones, the ones of the paravermal hemisphere, will cross. Well, first they go out of the of the cerebellum through the superior cerebellar peduncles, and they cross in the decussation of the superior cerebellar peduncles, and they arrive to the red nucleus. The ones of the facial nucleus, they just descend again through the inferior cerebellar peduncles and go to the reticular formation and vestibular nuclei. Vestibular nuclei are at the level of the medulla. Reticular formation could be at the level of the pons medulla. And pons medulla, midbrain, also because it's around the great mater, periaqueductal great mater. And the red nucleus are at the level of the midbrain. Now, all these neurons that are on the red nucleus, vestibular nucleus, and reticular formation. So we have seen up there now the bodies of the neurons that will now send axons. These axons will end up on in lower motor neurons, here to this lower motor neuron, here to this lower motor neuron, here to this lower motor neuron. So they are influencing the movement. The reticular spinal and vestibular spinal are mainly two extensors, and the red nucleus go mainly to inferior motor neurons that go to flexor muscles. So if we damage the red let's say above the red nuclei, in which we are damaging all this pathway, then we are kind of damaging the upper motor neuron, or the upper motor neuron concept. Don't worry very much here because we will touch it in a very detail, but I want you like to know because this is a little bit confusing. So here just try to refresh your memory, and in the next video make you understand why this is true. That it will be kind of this, just like a little bit slower. So if we damage this, we are not innervating these interneurons that are between the upper and lower motor neuron, and so the patient will present with a flexor muscle because the lower motor neuron is not inhibited. So the patient presents with a decorticate flexor, a decorticate posture. If we damage the vestibulospinal tract, that is certainly below the red nuclei, there is no inhibition of the lower motor neuron because this vestibular nuclei is sending axons not only to the lower motor neuron but also to the interneuron that is here, that is an inhibitory neuron. So because we don't have this inhibition, then the lower motor neuron is all the time contracted, is excited, and so is contracting the muscles, mainly the extensor muscles, and so the patient presents with a extensor posture or a decerebrate posture. Now in the next video we are going to compare the anterior dorsal cerebellar tracts and this cunocerebellar tract, and in the next video now the detailed explication of a decorticate versus a decerebrate posture. So here now just remember: neuromuscular, neurotendinous, in spindles, dorsal root ganglia, above T1 they synapse on the accessory nucleus of cuneatus. Between T1 and L3 they go directly to the dorsal nucleus of Clark. Below the lumbar level, they go into the gracilis fascicle. Without synapsing, they ascend to the dorsal nucleus of Clark, and then they join with the other ones. They turn a little bit lateral, so they go in the lateral funiculus as the dorsal spinocerebellar tract. They pass a little bit posterior and peripheral to the spinal tract of the trigeminal nerve, and they ascend or passes through the inferior cerebellar peduncle, arrives as Mossi fibers. They go to the vermal cortex, granular cells, Purkinje cells, fascial nucleus. From the fascial nucleus, the axons go through the inferior cerebellar peduncles to the reticular formation and vestibular nuclei, and then they go to the lower motor neurons. For levels above T1, we go to the accessory nucleus of cuneatus. These secondary neurons ascend as the cunocerebellar tract, passes through the inferior cerebellar peduncle as Mossi fibers, enter the paravermal cortex, de los sinapses son de granular cells son protein cells son de emboliform and globus nucleus, and the axons go out through the superior cerebellar peduncles, decussate in the decussation of the superior cerebellar peduncles, and they go to the red nucleus, from the red nucleus to the lower motor neuron.